thank you all for coming. And welcome to Gaming Futures. This is a panel about women in games playing and game making. I hope that you all had a chance to also stop by the students' demos and try some of the games that were developed here in-house at Wellesley by students. I'm Marie Cher. I am an associate professor in computer science, and I'm also co-directing the Media Art and Sciences program together with Dave Olson. Dave, if you can say hi. And I'll be moderating this panel today with Nick Knuff. Nick, if you can say hi, from the Cinema and Media Studies program. This semester, starting with the fantastic exhibit that was opened last night of Jason Rohrer's games, we're taking the time to reflect upon games and explore games from different perspectives in a series of events. And this is an exciting event in which we focus on women. We focus on women's role and vision for this future of gaming and how women take their roles in game making, studies game, critiquing games, being involved in the technical and in the creative aspects of game making. And now, without further delay, I want to introduce six fantastic and inspiring women, our panelists. I will not introduce them one by one. Instead, I will ask them to come here and introduce themselves through a short presentation. Each of the panelists will give a short presentation showing us her work, sharing her perspective and vision for the future, and then we will have time for a conversation. So the goal is to get an introduction to different perspectives and then have more of a discussion that comes from you and open to the panelists to respond. Thank you, Catherine.
Hey, so 10-minute introduction. So my little essay, personal essay here is this obsession I've had with how games move us. I am a new faculty member at the University of Santa Cruz, University of California, Santa Cruz, and so I haven't built up a big lab there, so I thought I'd show you the lab I built up at NYU where I was for 6 years, called the Game Innovation Lab, and my work is at the intersection of human-computer interaction and games and pushing the boundaries of what we can do with technology to create interesting experiences with games that can transport us and shape a different potential future for technology. And I got into this partly because I hate birds, and I want to share this anecdote with you. How will I get from A to B? Well, I've always hated birds. My first job out of college, I worked at a zoo outside of Chicago, and my office was right next to the birdhouse. And I would go through this gorgeous birdhouse every day, and I would see this beautifully designed exhibit, and I really still could care less. And in fact, I came to realize that the zoo by its nature creates a kind of distance and impersonalness in the relationship to the animals, but one day they wheeled in a kiosk. And it was a very simple video-driven game where you had to be a red-winged blackbird for a season. And I had to figure out where to put my nest and who to mate with, and I lost one of my nests, and I didn't get the other bird I wanted. I was like, damn it! And by the end of it, I had so much more empathy for birds. And it was this crappy video thing. I was like, whoa! And that's actually what threw me into grad school. I was like, I have to figure out what this medium is. And why does this work better than actually experiencing the being itself? Why do I have more empathy from this kind of very poor rendition of this animal? So I hauled myself off to Stanford and I got a PhD in communication of all things, and I did my dissertation work on how people relate to little characters on the screen. And right about when I was finishing up, the Microsoft Paperclip came out, and that probably most of you are too young to remember this, but I was like, no, category crusher, everyone hates little characters, what am I gonna do? Every time I told people about my thesis, they were like, oh, like that stupid paperclip. But then I realized that computer games have always had little characters in them and people love them. And I thought, you know what, I'm gonna study what game designers do and I'm gonna figure out what it is they do so well that makes us love characters. And this is the first book I did. This was actually directed at game designers, and it was essentially taking an understanding from psychology and all of the things that we know about how humans work and showing how great game characters use psychology. Now, I'm just finishing up another book, and that's what I want to speak just a tiny bit about today, which is for a different audience. It's for everyday people, the kind of people who listen to NPR in their car, trying to help them understand how games move people in new ways. And this is part of this Playful Thinking series at MIT Press. And these books are meant to sort of launch an argument about games. And I want to help people understand what I understood intuitively all those years ago, because I feel like our cultural conversation about games is kind of still pretty crap. And there's a lot of, you know, dissing of games. Sometimes I feel like I work in the pornography industry when I go to parties and tell people what I do, and that just makes me mad. So I think, and a lot of game designers think, that games actually have a unique emotional vocabulary. So here's a quote from a very famous game designer. He says, people talk about how games don't have the emotional impact of movies. I think they do. They just have a different palette. I never felt pride or guilt watching a movie. And he talks about when he played this game, Creature Isle, which is a very old game. Again, not terrific graphics, but you had this creature. You could either train it to be good or evil, and then it would behave based on how you treated it. So he was curious about the evil branch, and he started slapping his creature, and then felt really horribly guilty about it. And I mean, he was a software designer. Why should he feel guilty? And that launched him into this very deep thought process about why it was that this was happening. And if you look at research on how we work as human beings, you can see that when you have agency, very different sorts of things happen emotionally. I can't get into all the arguments of the book here. I can give you one example of a really interesting game by Anna Entropy. And this game was designed specifically to be installed at Occupy Oakland. And it's a game in which the game mechanics and the way the avatars are constructed are all designed to create a very particular feeling in people. So you get one of these characters assigned to you, and you're opening these gates, and you're trying to ascend together to a higher level collectively, and you can sort of choose to sacrifice yourself and the moves you make so that others can advance further, basically on your own back. And this game, I'm going to quickly show this video link, and then I'll be done, I promise. Was installed in this arcade cabinet, was literally wheeled around at this Occupy event, and the idea was actually they were going to take over this building, and they were going to put this game in there, kind of almost like a beachhead of, yahoo, we did it, you know, here's this game. And in the process of playing the game, you could kind of recapitulate what was happening in the movement. Now, unfortunately, they got turned away, and that protest got turned kind of ugly. But I think what's amazing about this example is the sophistication of design to evoke a particular set of emotions, not just in individuals, but also collectively. And there's a lot of other examples like that in my book. So to conclude, my basic premise is that game designers have already innovated really powerful design language for creating unique emotions in people, and that this is something we should be talking about more in everyday life as we go about understanding the role of games in our culture. And that's it.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you so much to the organizers. This is a really terrific event. I'm happy to be here. So I'm a scholar and a theorist with a background in visual studies and cultural studies. And so I'm going to really go through quickly like a few of my influences and give you a sense of some of the things I'm invested in. And then I'd like to make a little bit of a shorter statement about a problem I see and some things that I think are really exciting about gaming futures. So one influence here, Stuart Hall, because I come from a cultural studies approach in some of my training, he's been really important for me in my own research and thinking about forms of culture, particularly television, film, games, thinking about them as myths which represent narrative form, the resolution of things which can't be resolved in real life. What they tell us about is about the dream life of a culture, and I think when we're thinking about games, that's a really important aspect. Evan Narcisse, an interesting critic of games, who you may or may not be familiar with, but I think he's an interesting games journalist who's starting to write about race and identity issues in games in a really interesting way in terms of mainstream games. And three books that you may or may not know of, Adrian Shaw's recent book, Gaming at the Edge, very important player, character, interaction, and identification. Really interesting work dealing with how we relate to our characters and whether or not we're closely aligned with them when we play. And then two older books, which you may not be familiar with, Game Cultures and Tomb Raiders and Space Invaders. Two really important texts for me in my own writing when dealing with games, but games as a form of culture as opposed to the technical kind of dimensions of games. Lastly, for now, Fox Harrell, whose work is important to me because he talks about phantasms in games, which is kind of related to the notion of ideology, the idea that we understand certain things in the literalness of the images we see, but also a lot of inferences and ideology around what we see in these games as well. And just as in terms of games as social in their hardware and software as well. So games are not isolated or fundamentally separated from larger culture and its dominant ideologies as forms of media culture that are routinely castigated in the mainstream as being the most debased and rapaciously capitalistic forms. Games have gone largely without serious consideration of representation and the politics of identity, particularly within academia and also in popular media. So games are engaged in extremely complex and nuanced representational effects, while despite some of the interventions I've mentioned here, we're told again and again that games don't matter in the mainstream, which I think in terms of the students I actually see, that's very much not the case. They mean a lot to them. So games are mass culture forms that constitute powerful ways that people come to understand their place and possibilities in the world through complex persuasions and even through social engineering. Understanding these machinations can really endow us with more agency as stakeholders within a given culture in a given moment. So recent games culture wars, such as, I'm sure how many of you are familiar with Gamergate, at least in general, you've heard it, right? Yeah. So, these kinds of culture wars have definitively confirmed that games do traffic in the politics of representation, just as any other form of mass media. For example, these retrograde images of women as hypersexualized or passive or dehumanizing racial or queer images still pervade the mainstream industry, although I do think that more attention is being now drawn to that for the industry to be better. So observing these representations of others in games clearly shows us how issues of difference and power do remain at the forefront of the struggles for socially defined minorities. And it marks a persisting anxiety around the presence of certain constituencies in the mainstream, in technological fields in general also, of which games is now truly a multi-billion dollar global industry. So the Gamergaters struggle to keep games safe from the what they called social justice warriors, right? Social justice issues that seeped into and ruined games, right? Is the extension of a false dualism between this notion that there's an activist group that's doing some kind of identity politics and then a normative group that's somehow not doing identity politics. And this is something that I wanted to talk to today as the core of a kind of a problem, right? So this places the activist group's work in an inherently kind of marginalized position as being political, and at the same time implicitly constructs the normative group as not activist and not political, and most importantly, not practicing a form of identity politics from within a dominant position. So there's such a sense of unshakable domain over this realm of representation still that it becomes this very aggressive form of territoriality and an identity politics at play that's not really being named properly. So I no longer think it's important to merely point out the racism of particular games, although I think that work is important to be done, but not under the base presumption that there's a form of ignorance going on, right? That in fact, it's more a form of essentialism, because as I mentioned in an earlier essay, specifically having to do with art, contemporary art and culture, an essay called Uneasy Bedfellows, which I think I have an image here. Yeah, this is from the essay itself. A co-authored essay, I talked about how all forms of image production overlap with identity, whether or not the makers occupy a normative position, and whether or not identity is foregrounded in the work itself. So this is something that, with my co-author, we argued in this essay, and I do think it's very important for games as well. So quickly, I just wanted to mention a couple more people. Anna Everett, who's very important. During a 2014 interview, Anna Everett described the persisting resistance to speak on race, gender, and identity politics, stating, quote, racial and gender assumptions still operate as functional structuring presences underlying too many of games' procedural rhetorics and tropes of mastery. Also, Lee Alexander, who I don't have pictured in a Time magazine article on Gamergate, which was shocking for me to ever see that kind of material in Time magazine, described the incidents of Gamergate as, quote, sharp growing pains in the industry, ultimately characterizing the debate as, quote, a tension between games as product and games as culture. So I think this gets to the core of certain ideas. Dominant games present a vision of the world that seems mostly very devoid of postmodern, post-structural, post-colonial, feminist, queer, or any other real critical intervention. And so I do maintain that it's central to understand formalist pursuits in games and the restriction of video game studies to formal material aspects of game studies as really actually a kind of identity politics unto itself, right? So Gamergate was really important to me because I feel that it created a kind of eruption of something that would normally be pervasive but invisible to public view, which is that it made visible the normally hidden identity politics at play in dominant games. So just a couple things really quickly that I'm excited about. I think there's some really great conversations that are beginning to open up, partially around the goings-on of Gamergate, but also just development in terms of scholarship. Miguel Sicard, if you haven't heard of him, really interesting progressive scholar dealing with ethics in games, but not merely if you can play the game as good or bad, but really thinking about the ethical inquiry that is generated in the player as a result of being faced with difficult ethical choices within a game, which I think is a more complex way of coming to things. Also, Mary Flanagan, Helen Nissenbaum, also a similar text, Values at Play. Really interesting text I recommend to you if you haven't seen it already. I'm also very, very excited by the idea of increasing access to game development tools. I think more and more people who don't necessarily have coding experience per se are able to make viable games that they can share with other people. And the modes of sharing are improving as well. I think that's great and we should talk about it. And then lastly, I'd just like to mention before I stop that criticism. I think real, rigorous, intellectual, searching game criticism is necessary. And I'm not talking about a game review, right? Something that's connected to industry, but criticism in the sense of a tradition that we already have from theater, from film, from other forms of creativity, for which we no longer need to even ask the question as to whether criticism is important, right? It's understood, and I think games are complex enough that they are certainly worthy of that. And I also know that my students are always interested to know what is to be said in terms of that, because games actually form a primary form of visual literacy, a visual culture for them at this point. And so they really want to know how to think about these complex images that they're seeing. So I don't know if my time's up, but I just I think I'll stop right there. Thank you.
Hi guys, I'm Rayla. I'm here to talk about my experience in the game industry, how I got to my current position, and just some thoughts that I have about staying inspired as a creative writer. I'm a writer in the games industry. So first off, what can games writing achieve? Game writing offers storytelling potential that film, TV, and play writing can't necessarily achieve. In that games are inherently interactive. The player is put right into the middle of the protagonist's head. They almost become the character that they're playing. And they have inherent agency because of that. They're constantly making choices in the game that will determine how the game plays out. And they're responsible for what happens because they make those choices. So here's an example, The Walking Dead, really fun game. There's a scene where obviously, you're in a zombie apocalypse. For those of you who don't know The Walking Dead, there's a scene where you only have 4 food items and you have 10 people in your camp, and you have to make a decision who to give these food items to. And the people around you are children, there are people who have lost loved ones, there are people that you want to make alliances with, and then there's yourself. And you have to decide who to give the food to, who deserves the food. The choice you make here determines how these characters interact with you for the rest of the game and can actually change the course of the ending in the game. Another example is Don't Starve, one of my favorite games. It's an open world game where you play as this quirky, a variety of quirky characters you can choose from, and it's a survival game. So you have to gather items, you have to forage, you have to hunt. And it's a very brutal, punishing game. If you don't do it right, you will die many, many times. this, because it's an open world game, you can kind of do anything. You can go in any direction. You can use a variety of methods to survive. You can go on a hunting route and kill everything you see at the risk of dying yourself, or you can just be a forager and collect everything around you. So as a player, you kind of determine how the story goes based on decisions you make in the game. Here's another game that just came out, That Dragon Cancer. Really amazing game made by two parents who lost their son to cancer at age 5. And it's a memoir for them, so it's their experience going through this tremendous loss and suffering of their son. And it's a really interesting story in that you can't change the ending when you play. The son dies of cancer. But what you can change is how you get to that place, how you comfort the son as he's suffering through this disease. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about my career. I actually started in the film industry. I was a CAMS major, 2010, an English minor. So I worked in the film and TV industry for a couple years before transitioning to games. And I've always been really passionate about story, so that's kind of where my interest lies. I worked in development, I worked in production, and I worked in distribution in film out of Hong Kong, actually, before moving to LA to work in a more creative capacity. I kind of got stuck in the film industry as an assistant, which is really common. You kind of have to work your way up for a really long time before you can get to a creative role. So I landed a temp job at a game studio, thinking that I would only stay for a short time. I didn't really understand that games could be a career track for me. I had always played games, but I never understood it as something I could make, too. And I fell in love with the company culture. I really enjoyed the way that people kind of cared about my career path and wanted to hear what I had to say, which is something that I didn't always have in my film jobs. The next challenge for me was going from an admin role to a creative role. When I started, I was a coordinator. I managed calendars. I organized events for departments. It wasn't really what I wanted to do with my career. So I actively networked within the company. I found some creative executives that cared about my career trajectory and kind of just asked them for advice again and again until they gave it to me. And it worked. I was able to get in the room to meetings that I wasn't necessarily like qualified for and offer my opinion, give people my feedback on their work, and also pitch ideas myself, which was a huge learning curve. Like when you're first pitching ideas, it takes a while to understand what works and what doesn't work. So it was a really big learning process for me. And eventually I was able to start writing stuff too, which is what I'm really passionate about. So for about a year or so, I kind of worked as a writer without officially being a writer. So I like to say I snuck my way in. And eventually I was promoted to a writer, so I am officially a writer now. But in a lot of competitive industries, you kind of have to do the job before you get the job. So it's definitely challenging, but if you're persistent, you can definitely do it. Okay, what else? So what I do now is I do world building and I do character development. World building is creating the world within a game that you're working on. So it's everything from creating environments to creating magical fantasy characters to magic systems to magical creatures. Anything that belongs in the world, you invented. So it's a lot of fun. And then I do a lot of character development too. So I take characters from the game and try and make their stories deeper, more nuanced, more interesting, hopefully more realistic. And we spend a lot of time trying to make the characters as robust as they can be, because character is really, really important in story, and especially in games. Okay, so I also have some tips on job hunting, because it's definitely tricky. Took me a while to get to where I was. The best advice I got when I was first starting out was that networking is actually just finding friends and making friends. It's really intimidating to go to networking events and meet a bunch of strangers and try and pitch yourself and get a job or try to help them get a job. So if you view it as just making friends, it's a lot easier and more fun, I've found, and can actually lead to jobs eventually. And also networking horizontally. When we think of networking, we often think of finding a boss who's going to hire you, but networking with your peers is really important because your peers are going to be the people that are going to rise up with you and they'll help you like throughout your entire career. So that's been really valuable for me. And in new career, in new industries like the game industry, there isn't always a set career track. You kind of have to figure it out as you go along. Another thing that is really important is doing things before you're officially qualified to do them. And if you don't have a job where you can do that, just make things with your friends. I definitely did that a bunch when I was in the film industry. I would go out on weekends and do like a 48-hour film competition where we would just make a film in a short amount of time. And now I've done it a couple times with friends where we make games in a short amount of time. And that really helps you gain the necessary skills that you need to get to that next step in your career when you don't necessarily have a job that will give you the experience you need to get there. The last thing I want to say is don't be afraid to completely fail. Failure is inevitable when you're learning something new. It can be really easy to try and stay in your comfort zone and do the things that you've succeeded at doing in the past. There's kind of an expectation to, I definitely had this at Wellesley, that I wanted to like do everything perfectly and do everything right the right way. But when you're entering a new field that you have no experience in, you're probably going to do it the wrong way a few times before you get it right. So being accepting of that helped me a lot when I was starting out. And lastly, just gonna get a drink of water. I want to end on this quote from Ira Glass, This American Life, anyone? It kind of inspired me when I graduated Wellesley. I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my career, so here it is. All of us who do creative work, we get into it because we have good taste. But there is this gap. For the first couple of years you make stuff, it's just not that good. It's trying to be good, it has potential, but it's not. But your taste, the thing that got you into the game, is still killer. And your taste is why your work disappoints you. A lot of people never get past this phase, they quit. Most people I know who do interesting creative work went through years of this. We know our work doesn't have the special thing that we want it to have. We all go through this. And if you are starting out or you're still in this phase, you gotta know that it's normal and the most important thing you can do is do a lot of work. You just gotta fight your way through. So, thank you.
Hi, I'm Cassie. I work for Microsoft as a program manager. And I work on a product called DirectX 12. That is an API for game developers to use. It's for graphics developers, and I'll get in a little bit more to what that means, but I am very much so on the opposite end of the spectrum from Rayla, who works on the creative side. I work on the lowest possible level, pretty much, of games. So I don't do creative stuff. I do the analytical, sort of technical stuff. So just to give you guys an overview of what the game stack looks like, this will help you understand the context of where I'm working. So at the top level, you have people who are writing the story, who are making the art, who are doing the animation. They produce their work, and you put that into a game engine. So game engines are kind of like Unity, some of you guys have worked with that, Unreal, and custom engines. And the engines kind of control what the universe does at its fundamental level. Like, how does physics act in the game? What are some of the like color palettes across the entire game? And graphics developers make those game engines. So what I work on is DirectX, which is a graphics API, and those game engines are made on our API. So basically, I work on the graphics team, and we put pixels on the screen. So if it is on the screen on your monitor, then it has to have come through us at some point. And so what we do is I work with between the people who make the game engines and the hardware people. So we're working with NVIDIA, AMD, and Intel, who make GPUs, which are graphics processing units. That's the card that's physically in your machine. Those cards have drivers, and those drivers are what process sort of what comes from our API and goes to the hardware. So we're kind of at this very low level where we need to work with the hardware vendors to make their drivers good, and we need to work with the graphics developers so they can make engines that use that make very fast performant games. So to get an idea of why this is important, first I'll show a quick video of what some of the stuff that we work on looks like. Let's take a look. So DirectX is a new API, and we are trying to be as fast as possible. So here's a quick sample of something that's been released. A lot of DX12 games haven't been released yet. So this is one of Microsoft Studios games. It's called Fable Legend. So here's an example from Fable Legend. So this is a benchmark. And so what we do with benchmarks, audio's not done. Is that gonna work? Maybe not. So basically, we take benchmarks, and that's a sample from a game that shows the... is it working? Okay, great. There we go. So benchmarks, basically, we take a sample of the most like complicated parts of the game for rendering. Rendering is basically how you put things up on the screen. And we test it and see how fast it is with our new API. So that's a lot of what I work on. So this is just a short sample, and we'll get to a little bit more later. Okay, to this. So it's like a really pretty portion of the game that we use to test, see how fast our API is running. And let's get back to presenting here. Is it back up? Okay, there we go. To that. So why we do this is because gamers who play on PC care about a few things. And these are the things they care about. Everything has to be really fast. If you've ever played a game and you like notice that it's running really slow, you can't like shoot things in the right time, or you can't like catch the thing that you're chasing after, and you're like, why is this happening to me? I hate everything. I'm losing. I'm like not having a successful time killing things. Whatever you want to do. So gamers really care about speed, and how we measure speed in games is by frames per second. That's how many times your screen is refreshing when you're playing the game. So what we shoot for in like really good high quality games is 60 frames a second. So that means all of your code has to be running 60 times per second. That's real fast. Like we are optimizing at the millisecond level. So if you are using milliseconds like to do stuff that's just not optimized, we are going to be all over you for that. So we're like, you guys have to cut it down. So that's one thing. The other thing that gamers care about is hardware, and that's they buy expensive hardware. That's how they spend their money. Are they getting their money's worth for it? Are you buying good hardware and seeing performance from that? And so what we work on with our API is making sure that the hardware, people are seeing better performance with their hardware. As like I spoke about earlier, if you were using DX12, you have to have drivers for the hardware that go with that. So we work with the drivers, the guys from the hardware vendors, to make sure that their drivers are performant and everything's going fast on their good hardware. And we want to make sure that everything is consistent. Everything's rendering well. You're getting good things on the screen. You're not seeing errors. Things aren't looking the wrong color. Pixels are all on the screen. And you want to make sure it's fast and you're not getting that lag that really irritates people. So specifically what my team does is we work on AAA games. We work on the latest and greatest Xbox and PC games that are coming out to make sure that they all look really good. And to do that, we support the people making the games, so the game engines, as graphics developers, and we're also working with the hardware vendors to make their stuff really fast as well. Part of what I do is also I work on creating tools that developers use to do performance analysis on their own games. So kind of all of this stuff together basically results in really fast games, and that's what we need to see on the market, because that's how we stay competitive. So to talk more specifically about what I do, I work on title adoption, so I'm trying to get everybody to use DX12. I want people to be convinced that this is the greatest API, because it is. I work with first and third party studios, so that means I work with people who are employed by Microsoft to make games, kind of like Fable Legends, which we already looked at. And I'm working with third party studios, so people that aren't related to Microsoft but are still trying to use our stuff. So I want to help them meet their goals for performance. I want to make them really happy developers. They all should be smiling. I frequently have phone calls with them. We want to tell them everything's good and you're going to see exactly what you want. And we're providing them tools, and we often have to work with them to make sure everything in the tools department is working really well. And the other thing I do is I test these games myself. So a lot of studios will send us the games. And so before like they release to the public, I'll sit there and analyze them using like GPU and CPU analyzers. So there's some stuff where I can look at like what exactly is happening on the CPU or the GPU at all times. It's very low level, sort of tedious work where you're looking at numbers and running stats, but it's very interesting, especially when you get to kind of peek at the games earlier. So yeah, we also work with our hardware vendors. And if none of this makes sense to you, I have a video that explains a little bit more about what I do, and now I've learned to end the slideshow. Here we go. This is the short version of what I do. There's a lot of situations, and it's hurting cats. Just like this little boy, every time he catches a cat, they run back into the bushes. And that's what I do. I herd cats all day. So every time we have a studio that has an issue, every time we have a developer that wants to do something completely off the rails, every time a hardware vendor likes to change up what they're working on, we heard them like cats. That's my favorite video. So I pretty much, yeah, I work on title adoption and getting everybody happy with what we're doing. Let's back up. So a little bit about what I did before Microsoft. Well, as a class of 2015, I've only been there for about 9 months now. I majored in computer science and medieval renaissance studies. And I spent 2 years researching with ARIT in the HCI lab, and I worked on 3D problem solving with the ZSpace. And you see my little note, that's how I got Plinko'd into working on graphics at Microsoft. They saw Unity on my resume, and they said, like, that's great, we need people who understand middleware. Come join us here. So, very different from actually using Unity, but it's been a great experience so far, and it's a lot of really cool technology. And I'll go into a little bit, like, part of working in games is staying relevant and staying involved in the field. So a couple of things that I have done and will do is I went to PAX last year. You get to see a lot of the new games that are coming out. It's super cool when you've like worked on games and you get to see them on the show floor and people like seeing them and experiencing them for the first time. And I will be going to E3 this year, which is what the second photo is. And we'll be checking out some of the games that are getting announced there. And just to, in case you guys are wondering, what have I been playing? In case you want to talk about games later. I spent a lot of time playing League of Legends, Tomb Raider, Portal, and Life is Strange. So those are kind of the top games that I've been playing right now. Super fun. And yeah, so thanks for listening. And if you guys have any questions, feel free to touch today.
So I come from a very different angle. As far as games, not Portal or anything like that, or AAA games. I'm an art historian. I was actually, you know, together with Professor Soraya Murray at Cornell. That's where we met. And so I'm looking at games also from a cultural perspective, like she is. And I'm specifically really interested in this idea of games and art, play, and activism, social transformation. And like you heard yesterday, some of you that were here, and Jason was talking a little bit about that, there's been an emergence of artists and designers that are really interested in using the medium for, you know, to speak to social change, right? And this is where I'm coming from. This is what I did my graduate work in. My whole dissertation was actually about looking at artists from a global perspective. So artists everywhere, really in the world, they are using the medium because it's so popular to speak to particular social issues, right? And I looked at the histories of those games, looking through avant-garde art and the use of play. So I looked at Dada, looked at Fluxus, and so on and so on. And that's where I'm coming at in terms of games. So I'm really interested in history, right? I'm an art historian, not for nothing. So I wanted to show you and share you a little bit about that history and game history, right? I can show you lots of artists and women artists that you know, are known for being game designers in art. But I thought you could do that. You know, you can go to your library actually and do that. In the archives, you have games by Takako Saito, who is a Japanese artist that did nothing throughout their career but design games. So you can actually go to the Rare collection and look at that. So who we are looking at is actually somebody that should be really, really famous as a game designer in the United States because she's the inventor of Monopoly. Do you know her?
Yeah.
How many of you have played Monopoly? All right, so some of you know about Lizzie Maggie, okay? And she was the woman that actually asked the patent, or had the patent in 1904, and all. This is how it looks like. The Landlord's Game, and that's You know, that's not what you see on the box when you play Monopoly, okay? What you see is this other person on the other side, one Charles Darrow. And he was the one that got the patent from Parker Brothers and the money, you know? So actually, this is a story. It's kind of like an American Dream type of story that, you know, he got the money, got the contract and so on for Parker Brothers during the Great Depression, right, in the 1930s. But really what happened, he stole the idea from Lizzie Maggie, and you see her there on the side trying to claim, her invention. So basically, to add insult to injury, Monopoly was actually, it started as an anti-capitalist, anti-monopoly game. And so this is what you saw, and this is actually what she published. She actually had to publish the game herself because nobody else wanted to publish it. And what the game was done for is to illustrate an economic theory that was put forth by an economist, an American economist, Henry George. And the idea was to argue for one single land tax. So it was about people, you know, so the land would be held in common, and people that use the land would have to pay the tax. And this idea was to shift the burden of taxation to, big monopolies. And remember, this is around the same time as the Carnegies and so on. So she made this game, and then eventually she developed another game, which is now Monopoly. And the idea is that you would play these games together, and that you could then compare which one was morally superior. So this became really, really popular, and this is when Mr. Dare over there actually found out about the game through some friends on the East Coast, because again, this was like around the lefty circles, this was really popular. And then he claimed it for himself, right? So the fact that, we have Gamersgate, that we have women designers, you know, interested in games and so on, this goes way back. Okay, the sexism in the industry goes way back, and I don't want to depress you, but this is something to think about. So this is the story of Monopoly. We of course invited Anna Antrofia. She was not able to come. We're really sad about that, and of course she already talked a little bit about it. So this is her book. The book that you see next with Video Games for Humans is actually by Merit Kopas, and she is also another well-known designer, Twine game designer. If you want to know a little bit more about feminism and gaming, I put up the syllabus up there, Gaming and Feminism, which is actually put out by the New Inquiry. And this is a syllabus that it's evolving. If you want to know a little bit more about Gamergate, I strongly recommend that you watch GTFO, which I'm not going to tell you what it means. But watch it. It's something that just came out. And then briefly, why did I, what were we thinking about, having Anna Antrofi here? Basically, what she's arguing is, okay, we actually now don't need an industry to distribute these games, right? It's no longer about Monopoly. You have the internet out there, you have Twinery. You can actually download it and you can make some games. And some of you already made those games, right? I saw some of the games that you made using Twine. And you can actually upload it and you can publish it. And so what she says is, like, it's important that, we become represented as women and so on, transgender people and queer people and so on, that we are represented within the industry. But it's probably safe to say that the industry is not really interested for a long time in publishing games that have to do with very personal, narratives that have to deal with particular, you know, bodies, right? So issues with rape, issues with alternative sexualities, and so on. It's not likely that the mainstream industry will, you know, voluntarily put those games out there. So in the meantime, you can use Twine, so I encourage you to do that. And this is kind of what she had to say about this. So I just wanted to show you kind of like what happened, you know, 1984 or 1904 and, you know, 2015. So things changed a little bit. So, yeah.
So I'm Anna Loprev. I'm a postdoctoral researcher here at Wellesley College in the computer science department. I work with Ori Chayer in the HCI lab. And today I'm just going to talk a little bit about my background because I am a Wellesley alum, class of 2010. And so kind of how I got to where I am. So in undergrad, as I mentioned, I went to Wellesley. And while I was here, I was really interested in kind of doing as much extracurricular things that have to do with video games as possible. Obviously, at the time, we didn't have any sort of video game events or anything here, so I had to venture out into the city. And I was going to some of the classes at MIT's winter session, and that's where I discovered this group called the Singapore MIT Gambit Game Lab, now known as the MIT Game Lab. And this is a really cool group where undergraduate students can actually do as their research, join this lab, and develop games for research purposes. So the lab works with a lot of other departments and organizes this sort of game development. And students aren't just writing the code for these games. They're also working as the designers. They're working as project leaders. They're actually negotiating between the people who want to use the game and the people who are developing the game. So it's a really cool program. If anyone is interested in game design or development, I highly recommend you reach out to this group because they are still at MIT. Now, when I was there, I worked on a lot of different projects, and I had a lot of different roles, everything from design to development to testing. And the culture there was very interesting, was very open. There was a surprising number of females there, actually, doing not just design, but also even things like coding. And we'd get together every week, everyone would play games, we'd do critiques of different genres. It was a really cool atmosphere. And my favorite project I worked on, the biggest one, the one that had the most recognition, was a game called Waker. And this was done with the Education Arcade, which is an education group at MIT. And the game teaches displacement and velocity to students in non-direct ways. So the way the core mechanic works is essentially you have a little avatar that's over there on the right, and you can pick up an object in the world. It'll start to draw a graph based on your movement. And when you drop the object, the graph solidifies and you can jump onto it. So it kind of gives you that intuition of how these sorts of graphs relate to displacement and velocity. After my undergrad career, I decided I wanted to get a PhD in computer science. So I went on to grad school. And while I was there, I continued to have this interest in games and game development. And I interned at a local educational game company called Second Avenue Learning. Now this group was very interesting. It's a very small company, about 25 people, and it is a women-owned company. So the owner actually went to Smith. And I worked there as a designer, and the atmosphere though was very different from the game lab. And this was partially because it was industry rather than academia. So obviously things are a little more formal. A little more structured in terms of hierarchy. But also, unlike the game lab where you had kind of a mix of people from different departments, you had people, males, females, whatever, here, in terms of people on the lowest levels, it was me, the designer, and 10 male programmers. So it was very, very different. Like at the game lab, I worked on quite a few projects here, but my favorite one, which is a game that was unfortunately never released for various reasons, was called Targets. This is a really fun project because it was the first project I had that was kind of outside the normal realm of just a PC. This actually was an augmented reality and card game. So in the card game portion, you have these cards, each one representing a different type of atom for different elements. And you would have a target molecule you're trying to build, and kids would work together to build that molecule by putting in the different bonds and sticking things together. But the cool thing was you could also pick up a tablet and then play this sort of game in three dimensions. And now those same cards can be used to manipulate atoms and pull molecules apart in a 3D space collaboratively. So all this education, collaboration, game sort of stuff is what drove my eventual graduate research work. I went to the University of Rochester, and there I'm like, you know, collaboration, we can have these collaborative games, we can have educational games. Can we teach collaboration at the same time as other topics so that we can kind of integrate it easier into the classroom? And so for my graduate work, I actually got to use the same game I developed in undergrad. I modified it to be multiplayer and added in some help system to actually give these sort of tips and to promote helping behaviors among players to see if maybe this is one potential avenue we could take with game design. And the results were somewhat surprising. Unfortunately, the scaffolding, the help system, did not have any impact on helping behaviors, but it made people have a more negative opinion of collaboration. So then, of course, the next question is, why did that happen? Why did this approach, this particular approach to games not work? And so that's kind of my future work, is trying to figure out what could have caused that. So now I'm at the, as I mentioned, now I'm working at the HCI lab. I'm still doing things with collaboration, education, games. We have these awesome, large, multi-touch displays, so I'm really hoping to, like, kind of with the augmented reality game, get to work in more of the high-end, high-tech side of game design for future gaming platforms. So that's about it. Thanks.
Great. So now comes the time for you to have questions and to have a discussion with the panelists. And, you know, basically, I'm supposed to moderate this, but actually I'm going to basically let the panelists moderate this. We have a microphone for them, and really it's open to you to ask them and have any sort of conversation that you would like with them and questions that you have. So I'm going to pass this around. And does anyone have a question?
I have a question for Rayla. So judging from what you said, I'm guessing, could you just first clarify, do you do any dialogue work for the League Champions at all, or do you do mostly, like, lore?
I do the lore stuff, so, yeah.
So which champions have you worked on the League?
I actually can't talk too much about what I'm working on now, but if you come talk to me afterwards, I can talk to you.
So something that Catherine mentioned was that, like, when people talk about, like, when you talk about, like, the fact that you're, like, involved in games and you work on games, people kind of, like, respond negatively to that, even though there's, like obviously a lot of, like, areas for social change. What do you think is the best way to, like, evolve, like, the dialogue so that people don't think so negatively about, like, people working games?
Well, I think one interesting recent development is these playthrough videos where you can watch people experiencing a game. And I think even people who are avid players use those as a way, like an avenue into a game, and, you know, sharing emotional moments with games. So I think that gaming culture is starting to evolve scaffolding to help people understand. I think the big thing is you have to have a lot of skill and literacy to get deep into a lot of genres of gaming, and it can be pretty opaque to people who don't understand it. So finding these secondary ways to show and talk about it, I think will start to change that.
Could you elaborate on what you mean by, like, negative responses to working on games a little bit more?
Yeah, so mostly it comes from older people, and a lot of times it comes from people with children, like young children, who are really frightened of games. And I think it's a generalized technological anxiety, but I think it's coupled with the fact that the dominant spectacle they see on the screen is weaponry and killing, and they don't have much access to what I find interesting, they don't even have access to the fact that most of that crazy, gory, nasty killing is actually like really playful, goofy, silly stuff happening among peers and a lot of like kind of the equivalent of roughhousing on the playground, but they can't see that. They just see that visceral kind of gory spectacle and they have no idea about indie gaming. And so, you know, they come at me with all their anxieties about what's going to happen to their children. And, you know, that's understandable, but it's a conversation I've had many, many, many times. So I'm glad to be having this conversation.
Don't you find that you're often like showing examples then? Because what happens when I'm in the same situation is that they bring up, you know, Call of Duty, you know, and you're like, that is not the only game. And then you start talking about other games and they become really fascinated, at least I find they do. And then you introduce them to different things and I find they start coming back to me with like, would you suggest I play this with my kids or I do this? Or, and you start creating a dialogue and opening up their world as well.
Yeah, no, I think sometimes people feel a funny kind of a shame or fear, like they can't reveal, so you can become the confidant and the educator, which is a good thing to do.
Tacos.
Thanks. It was all very interesting. I wanted, however, to anybody who would like to answer this question, to ask, when do you feel that a game is a piece of art? When, you know, talk about the Call of Duty, and I would not consider it exactly art, but I've seen other things. What is the characteristics that would make a game feel like art?
Oh dear.
Do
you want to know? That's a dangerous
question. Yeah. Well, one thing, you know, if you want to go the Duchampian way, you know, if an artist makes a game and claims it's art, then it's art. You know, there's also, of course, it's a very blurry line, you know, so there's a lot of designers actually that are very steeped in, you know, the history of art. One of them that I write about constantly is Gonzalo Frasca. He's from Uruguay, and he makes these really, really smart games, and he's really interested in education and games. And he goes all the way back to Augusto Boal, and Augusto Boal being, of course, you know, from Brazil, somebody that was already not easy to pin down, right? He was using theater for activism, right, and literacy and so on. And so, you know, he's doing that on purpose. So what is Gonzalo Frasca? Is he a designer? Is he an artist? Who cares? You know, I guess that's, you know, and this conversation comes up time again, and maybe you want to talk a little bit about that with MoMA, you know, collecting games and what kind of games get collected and so on, and whether artists have access to that kind of collections, which is really important, right, to be collected by a museum. Yeah, it's, to me, it's a very blurry line between design and design and art, and it's a very old discussion. You know, it's like that discussion of art and craft. You know, like which one is the highest, and you know. So I think it's a very culturally marked discussion that has also to do with feminism, right? Like feminism was all about like, yes, women make craft. That's art. You know. So maybe you wanna.
Yeah, I mean, it's really thorny for me too, but I think that, like, I remember one of the reasons I got back into games was actually because that Our Games Art discussion was happening, and it was about like 2004, 2005, and Roger Ebert, the famous, you know, film critic, he said, games are not art, and people who play games should be, you know, spending their time doing something that will make them more cultured and civilized to each other and that kind of thing. There were a lot of stereotypes kind of embedded in his comment. And at the same time, I think it was even maybe the same year, it was interesting because Hideo Kojima, you know, who made, you know, the Silent Hill series and, you know, all these like really huge games, also said that games aren't art. You know, and I was kind of I was running between the two poles of these people. Like, on the one hand, someone who probably doesn't know a lot about games kind of saying this thing, and on the other hand, someone who knows a great deal about games and is also saying they are not art, but for a different reason. He was saying because they're fundamentally about pleasing a customer at the end of the day, and so for him, in the capacity that he's involved with them, that that for him it's not art, which is interesting as well, because he's one of the people that I think you would say within the dominant industry, the types of games that he's making creep the closest to something that seems to be much more deeply engaged with certain aesthetic considerations and, you know, a kind of affect, you know, that one might see as art-like, you know. And so I found that very interesting, but that's actually why I got into it. But for me, I would say that the question about whether or not a game is art is actually a question about something else, right? And it's actually a question about whether or not we think of it as being important enough to take seriously in culture, right? And I definitely think that there are many games, both dominant and alternative and private, you know, that are important enough to take seriously in culture. And so that's kind of more how I would answer that question.
Yeah. And I also want to add to that maybe that it has to do with the idea of art in our culture, right? Somehow we think of art as like being this pure, you know, thing that it's outside of economics. Not so, right? You know, arts is very part of the capitalist system, the way we think about it. So I think that it has to do with that kind of romanticism that art somehow is not tainted by money, you know? So I think that you can go that way as well and think about it in that way, if that makes sense. Yeah.
This is driving me nuts. So what I'm wondering is why we don't talk about this in other media. Like, you know, people hear people say, are books art?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we did, because if you go back, and I think this, and I keep harping on history, and I really do, like with my students. And if you go through history, we had these problems, you know, with photography. Oh my God, that's not art, you know. And now it's art. It's collected video art, exactly, and so on. So this is a recurring discussion, you know. And I think you're right that it has to do with, it has to do with like, okay, so if it's not art, then it doesn't matter, you know. And what does that mean? Because it does matter, you know. So it's kind of a slippery question, yeah.
So last night, Jason expressed this optimism about emerging game creators and designers using games not like as a place to insert like movie narratives, but as a place to express without interruption their own ideas. What do you think about this emerging generation? What do you think about like women's place within that group and like access to game development and creation as women
in STEM? Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
I can just
from the
teaching.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Okay, great question. Thank you. I'm personally very excited about it. I feel really positive because there's this class that I teach on campus, and it's called Video Games as Visual Culture. It's a class that I started, and it was like this crazy, ridiculous idea I had, and I took it to the, you know, the chair of the art history department thinking, okay, this is not gonna happen. But I just did it anyway, you know, and it actually got approved, and then students started coming, and suddenly it was like 175 students, and now it's grown to like 300 plus students. And there are lots of women, you know, in the class, and each year I've seen more women be in the class, and it excites me for many reasons. One, because I know that a lot of these students are making games themselves. They're, you know, enjoying existing games, but also making them or thinking about making them, thinking about telling their own stories, which I think is important, right? Just as, you know, the pieces in the exhibition, you know, they tell someone's story. I think that's really wonderful. And I also see like increasing sophistication around themes that people just didn't want to talk about anymore before, right? And so I see people being willing to tackle narratives, ideas, challenging themes within games because they always had games in their life. They existed before they were born, and because they understand it as a valid medium through which to tell a story. So I think things are only getting better. That's how I feel.
Yeah,
I would say the same thing, and this is why I asked Soraya to talk a little bit about this, because we are talking about, I also teach a class, and I have the same experiences, and it's actually more women, and there are women from everywhere. You know, I have students from everywhere, which is also really interesting, because the stories are different, depending on the cultural background. And one of the things that I ask my students to do is to actually create games. And I give them twine, and they have to, you know, create a game, and then they have to present the game. And it's really incredible, the things that they come up with. And it's, they find, a lot of them come to my, it's an intro class, so it's not only art students, it's students from everywhere. And a lot of them, and I was telling Soraya about this, have this idea that, you know, being a designer is like a cool thing, and it's, you know, it's going to be easy to put a game together and so on. And then they actually have to do it, and they're like, oh, this is hard. You know, and it takes them a long time to do the twine and so on. But it's incredible. It's just not, it's not perfect, you know. But it sparks a lot of discussion, because I have to discuss this in class. And so there's some deep things that people have to say, you know, about struggling with weight, depression, you know, I don't know, like family-related issues that would never come up in a class, like in an artistry class or a visual class. It would be me talking about this. And all of a sudden, it's the students, and they really get into it. You know, I have to cut it off. Actually, it's like, you have 10 minutes. You know, it just goes on. So I think it's really valuable. And I see women, especially, being very interested in doing this. Yeah.
So I'm on the executive board of this Higher Education Video Games Alliance, and we did a survey, and it turns out that there are more women in game design and development programs than in typical computer science and technical fields. And the other thing I wanted to mention is there's a whether you believe it or not, there's this Princeton Review rankings of game programs. So the number one program, which is at USC in Southern California, announced this year they have a majority of women in their MFA program. So those are a couple of data points about how women are doing in the educational side.
Nice. One thing I've thought about a lot is games as empathy, kind of. So when you play a game, you're put in the perspective of another person that is not you. It's someone else, could be a crazy monster, could be someone struggling with depression or someone suffering from a child with cancer, and it forces you to uncover what this perspective looks like and really put yourself into that perspective. And I think that's something that's really, really unique to games, that's different from any other type of media. It takes away the barrier between you and the art, or you and the book, or you and the print, or whatever it is you're looking at. You become that person. And I think that gives games a huge opportunity to create social change through empathy.
And just a note as well, like, in addition to having the sort of creative medium side of things, like, there's a lot to games that just comes from the technical side. If you're a computer science person, if you're a CS major, or anybody who wants to work on the foundations of games are incredibly complicated and technical, and that's where we don't actually see a lot of women right now, and where I would love to have more people coming and working with me. When I work at the level of an API or the drivers, the engines, I am one of three women on a team of 35 PMs. On my floor, I would say I know two female developers that are actually working on engines or APIs. And I have phone calls every day of the week and meetings every day, and I'm almost always the only woman in those things. And I think that there's a lot more to making games than the creative, the art, the story. There's a lot of technical stuff. The engines, and the studios, they all need more women as well. And so if you're looking at technical positions, there's a lot of space there for women to come in, and please do be interested in these sorts of areas as well. I don't know how many CS majors we have here. Quite a few. Yeah. So come talk to me if you guys are interested in those sort of more technical, lower level sort of things, because that's where I think definitely network for those. But do push for those as well. I would love to see more women in my meetings. I would love to go to some of these like special graphics things and not be the only woman there. And I think it's really important that we start exploring those spaces more. And I got extremely lucky that I got kind of plinkoed through the Microsoft system into this sort of very very male-dominated area. And I'm incredibly lucky to be there because I absolutely love it. And I think it's something that seeing more women in that area would be fantastic.
So, like, I know we've talked about, like, Catherine experienced the kind of stigma from the outside of working with video games. How has it been for, like, you two working in the industry from the inside? And is that, like, obviously there has been traditional stigma. Has that improved? Has it stayed the same? Because I know, like, from my experience, I haven't worked in games, but I've worked as an intern web developer. And it was, like, I had a similar experience, you know, a female-owned company, and like everyone was women, the marketers were women, the SEO people were women, but the developers were men. Yeah. And it was just like a really shocking kind of...
I've actually had an incredibly positive experience. I would say that I've found all of my coworkers to be incredibly respectful. Anytime I've faced anything that was less than respectful, it comes from people I don't directly work with. And I think it's because they have that distance from working with women. And those people that I've experienced that from, I have traditionally worked on teams with no women. And I think once you introduce more women into the workplace, working on teams that do have other women have been incredibly positive. I've seen a lot more respect from people, not only towards like their female coworkers, but also towards other employees. And I think it's incredibly valuable to introduce more women to these spaces. And I actually haven't had any, like, I don't have any outstanding stories that would make me want to quit my job. I think that I've had an overall very positive experience, and I think it's definitely a valuable experience.
In terms of stigma of the video games in general, or video games in general, working in video games, there's definitely a lot of people that don't know what it is. Like when I tell some people that I work in games, they're like, oh, so you play games all day or you're a programmer, or like there's a lot of confusion there just because it's a relatively new industry and it's not necessarily clear what all the jobs are. But I think it's changing. I think people are starting to see games as an art form and starting to see games as an expression for creativity. And there's so much variety of games nowadays, which is really amazing. As the other panelists have mentioned, it's easier than ever before to make a game, and that's only going to increase with time. So I think as the technology gets better, more and more people are going to make games, and the diversity will increase because of that. So that's definitely a good thing.
I just wanted to add, so when I was working at Second Avenue, and it was me and 10 guys, I will say it was never anything malicious. It was not like a negative atmosphere. It was just a little different, right? You have different conversation topics and just kind of act around each other differently. But I never, you know, I don't know if any of you have ever felt like the only woman in the room with a bunch of guys, and never felt like that there. So there definitely was a level of respect among the coworkers, which was good.
More about women on the other end, so as like gamers, as players, and I guess I'm specifically talking about games that have a very large spectator sport following, League of Legends, right? And as you see, the kind of the ideas are wrestling with, like entities that we're talking about in terms of game narrative play on the field, like what people are actually playing, where groups of people who are playing, usually men, like the teams that are in league who are women don't exist, or if they do, they're considered bad, whether they are bad or because they're women. So I guess any thoughts about seeing these kinds of identity struggles that could be created in the game play out as games are now more of a sport-like, spectator-like kind of entity?
Mm-hmm. I've heard people talk about this, and one thing that I've overheard people say is they don't understand why there are no like women esports players because it's not about strength, and that's obviously a really terrible way to look at it. What it goes to show is that it's actually about prejudice. It's not about anything to do with physicality at all. Women are generally discouraged from playing games. Like there's a stigma that comes with saying, "Oh, I play video games in my free time." Like, not everybody sees that as a positive thing. And I think it's a challenge because there aren't a lot of figures that are out there already, and the figures that are public figures are harassed to a huge extent and put down a lot. And the only way that can change is by fighting it, by enduring the harassment, and by being a public figure and standing up for equality.
I just wanted to add, I remembered I'd read an article, it was a while ago, where there was one esport where they decided to try to fix the problem by making a women's league. And there was a lot of backlash to that because they're like, well, what now? Women can't be in the main league. We have to be in our own side league. So the point is there is no like easy fix to it. And it is a very something that's ingrained in the culture that we have to just kind of slowly try to change over time by setting a good example.
So I'd have asked all women's legal weapons team that existed and tried to play professionally was Team Siren. It disbanded in 2013. Mm-hmm. And when it disbanded, they said it was because of friendship drama and kind of like just team dynamics. And because of that, they were criticized, oh, it's because of women. Even though a lot of like male teams also disbanded for the same reason. So kind of like women have to go through that extra barrier to kind of like prove that they're just as capable. And similarly, like in the industry, there's kind of a stereotype that like women are all like UX or UI designers or they're like more in a creative field, and then they have to go through like an extra step to prove that like I guess like they understand like the back end things as well. What do you think can be done, or like what kind of things could we do like going forwards to kind of like change the dialogue?
Yeah, so I actually had a pretty explicit conversation with my manager about that because I was like, you know, I've noticed that I'm like one of the only women on this team and potentially like one of the only more technical women. And he basically had what I thought was probably the best attitude towards this sort of situation is that, yes, you are one of the only women on this team. We are hoping to change that. However, you know, we still hold you to the same standard as all of the other guys on the team, but we will acknowledge when it comes around to review time and promotions and your opportunities here that it took a lot for you to get here. It took a lot more for you to get here than it took a lot of the other guys on the team. And we like respect and acknowledge that. And I think that working on the more technical side of things, that is, I think, one of the best ways to kind of go about thinking about it is like let's acknowledge that we've had like a much harder time getting here and like support those people who have had a harder time getting here. But like, let's all like do our best to make sure we're all like on the same playing field. And I think it's like that's I think the attitude from my manager that I would totally expect. Does that make sense? Does that answer your question? Okay.
So when you're in a position of power as a woman, you're supposed to help other women. Basically.
Yes. So my manager's manager is a woman, and so that's how far I have to go up the chain to get to a female manager, but. After every meeting with all of the PMs, program manager, so she holds an all-hands meeting, so all the PMs come. She definitely takes extra care to come talk to all the women afterwards and make it very clear that she knows them, that they are known in the company, she recognizes their hard work, and I really appreciate that as somebody who has to go up so far in the chain to meet another like female who is in like power. So I think that's like a definitely a positive experience. And I think that's the best way to help out other women in the industry is really to make sure that once you get to a place where you have a position of power, you help other people.
I do also think that it's really important. Like one of the things that I felt when I was teaching the gigantic class is that my presence at the front of the classroom speaking competently on the subject of games was almost an activist gesture in itself, you know, because it normalizes the presence of, you know, diversity, you know, like within the field, and I realized that in school I never ever saw that, and just seeing that I can imagine would be helpful to someone who can then potentially imagine being themselves in that position, and so that's one thing I think to do that. I mean, there are different ways of being activist, and it might not be like with the flag at the front fighting, you know, but also just persistently being there doing this thing, right? And others observing the fact that you're doing that, right? And the other thing that I think is really important is that when you're in the process of something difficult, I think it's really important to try to understand why that thing is actually happening to you and have some kind of perspective on what's actually happening, because you will get into some thorny situations sometimes. But, you know, I think, like, for example, you know, my understanding is that video games are, in fact, a really powerful way in which people become acclimated and comfortable with technology, right? So the idea that one gender would be socialized very easily into that and another might be less encouraged into that says something to me about a larger issue, right, that we need to work on in culture. But if you understand what's happening to you when you're being mocked for playing a video game, right, is part of this larger kind of consideration of a way in which perhaps women are less funneled into technological areas. You know, there's a way in which you can have a perspective on what's happening to you in the moment when, you know, when you're feeling like something's happening that you don't like, right? And if you have that, then you have the power of actually making a decision in the situation, you know, for your own benefit. So I don't know if that makes sense, but I think it's important to kind of understand the dynamics. And I think that gaming is really actually very important for young people to become comfortable with technology in general and go on to more technical things later that are less accessible.
Just to add on that, sometimes when people who are uncomfortable with games talk to me about them, I say, well, what do you do all day? You sit in front of a computer? Video games are training for that. Right. Why do you think our culture evolved them? It's like kid training for desktop labor. It's like the same thing. It's like if you don't understand anything else about video games, it's like we're monkeys and we're learning the tools of our monkey trade in the 21st century. So.
Had any thoughts about it. So throughout my career as a game professor, I have taught the majority of male students. But what I've done is I've infused all my teaching with a very high and blatant level of feminism. I've raised a generation of feminist male game designers, which was entirely deliberate. So I just wanted to hear you all talk a little bit about that, about how we negotiate that, you know, because there's always this thing put on, the women have to fix it, you know, and I realize that that's not going to work. It doesn't work for anything else, and why would it work for this? So I'm just curious your thoughts about that, the experiences you've had, or in your teaching philosophy, how you integrate that into teaching men and women. And
I want to speak to that. One thing I want to say is that I think men in our culture get a much narrower emotional range to work with that sometimes they find really constraining. And so even beyond, like, even labeling it explicitly as feminism, offering a wider range of design experiences and ways of talking about it can open up this terrain that's actually very liberating to them. And part of how I kind of see this is because my husband's German, but he's also like German Jewish. His dad was raised in Bolivia. So he has all these other cultural subtexts going on. And like, he has access to all these feelings that a lot of my male students didn't have. And so I think that's another way that I've always looked at it is, what can you offer that's sort of broader? And then I think a lot of times the guy students, sometimes they take it up and they're like, oh, whew, you know, it feels like taking a bra off in a way, you know, the male equivalent.
My strategy is to be really frank and open and to kind of get past that bad part of the class, like right at the beginning where all the, you know, normative white men in the classroom feel totally indicted, even maybe by me just standing at the front of the room, you know, and just to get past that, you know, and then after that, I think to just for me, I think it's also, I'm very self-conscious about the types of readings that I include, like I don't, and also where I include them. I don't like to have like a seminar that has the one day that's gender day and that's it, but always to include examples by many different kinds of people in all aspects of the class. So I don't have these assigned, isolated, I'm very intersectional. I guess that's what I like to say, is I'd like the classroom experience to be intersectional so that, you know, we don't have this pigeonholing of this identity and this identity and this identity, you know.
Hi,
I guess that's what I do. So one of the things that I would recommend, for example, is to get this wonderful book by Mary Flanagan. It's called Critical Play. And you just structure the class around that. So they don't even know that you are talking about feminism until you know, like week four, week five. They're like, there's a lot of women that she's talking about, you know? And she's like, oh, dear, you know? And then they find out. Another thing that I, and this speaks to this idea of women and technology that I really emphasize is that games are not technological in the sense of what we think about as these things, you know? So one of the things that I ask them is to rethink this idea of what it is that technology is, right? So I start my class with Peter Bruegel's children's, you know, paintings, you know, and go up. So like so that she has like she broke up the book in, for example, she starts with dolls, you know, and it's like about house play and whatever, and then language games and stuff. So I start with that and I break it up, you know. So I start like, you know, with Bruegel and then end up with The Sims. You know, and so the boys sit there and they're like, oh shoot, I've been playing The Sims and it's actually I've been playing house. Oh dear, you know. So they realize these things. And then we talk about dolls, you know, and I ask them what they did with dolls and stuff, and whether the boys, you know, played with dolls. And the boys are like, no, we didn't play with dolls. And then we talk about action figures, and they're like, ew. You know, so this is the way you structure the class. And I've been doing, like, this is my fourth time, and I'm getting better at it. And it's actually really funny. You get to enjoy this, you know. So this is how I kind of go about it. I don't tell them, frankly, what it is. I just say, well, this class is about critical play, and let's define what critical play is, and it's about subversion and so on. They're like, oh. And so it goes at, you know, it progressively. And of course, you know, we are talking about this today. We're going to have evaluations that say things like, if I wanted to take like a gender studies class, I would have taken a gender studies class, you know, but it's like one or two people, you know. If I go and stand up there and say, we're going to be talking about feminism and daughter, they'll be like, see ya, you know. So, yeah, I guess that's one way of going about it. Yeah.
I've been on the receiving end of Professor Noob's class on games, and I find the circle of magic, the gaming circle of magic concept that I think is in Flanagan's book, correct? That is the most useful argument for any conversation ever, and I've annoyed the crap out of my coworkers with it. Because they're all like, I don't understand why, like, women don't like this game or why women don't like that game. I'm like, okay, imagine the scenario. Now imagine how this breaks the circle of magic for you. And they understand that so well. That concept works for every like, feminist argument that I've ever had. I talk about it, and I love that argument so much. It's so easy. Everybody gets it. They're like, oh, I guess that would kind of like ruin your game playing experience. Like that would burst you out of your bubble. And I think that's like a fantastic concept.
See, it works.
It works. All right, on that note, let's thank our panel for a great presentation.
Great, so we'll be here for a few more minutes if you want to sort of come down and formally interact with our panelists. I just want to take the opportunity to thank two key people that without them we couldn't make this day. One of them is Lauren Westendorf that is here and really helped. The other one is not here because she's already kind of in the next step organizing our dinner, and this is Rita who had been fantastically helpful in making it all happen. So I'll thank her again without you present, but I also wanted to mention how helpful she was for making this event. And thank you all for coming.